Hello, and welcome to the Ferguson Library and the Stanford Symphony's Listener's Guide to the Three Periods of Beethoven's Music. My name is Gabriel Schaff, and I have had the privilege of playing in the first violin section of the Stanford Symphony for three decades. As a music historian, I have been asked to present my thoughts on Beethoven's extraordinary life and creations in celebration of his 250th birthday this year in 2020. Whether it be the creations of Beethoven, Picasso, James Baldwin, Emily Dickinson, the Beatles, or any art form that connects skill, depth, and heart, a little knowledge and context of the creators and their times will reveal deeper and more meaningful layers of appreciation. I have long been fascinated with the lives of great thinkers and artists, not only by what has been left to posterity, but also by their origin stories that encourage us to climb into their minds and try to see the world through their eyes. Humans love to organize facts and figures, and Beethoven's music has long been subjected to these somewhat artificial structures. His compositions are divided into three periods: the early period, the middle or heroic period, and the late period. Traditionally, the early period of his compositions are said to have begun with his arrival in Vienna in 1792 at the age of 21. However, the brash and energetic young man was already a seasoned composer with more than 50 diverse compositions under his belt, several of them significant artistic creations. It would be impossible in a single talk to catalog the bulk of this work that spans the years 1783 to somewhere past 1800, but I hope to give you a meaningful overview that you can apply to other pieces you listen to. Born on December 17, 1770, Beethoven's immediate environment presented the paradox of a dysfunctional family within a stable external society. Young Ludwig was the third generation of musician to serve the Archbishop-Elector of Cologne, whose court was based in the provincial German city of Bonn, not far from the French border. For those unfamiliar with pre-revolutionary Europe, it is important to note that political and religious institutions had been merged since the Middle Ages. Ludwig's father, Johann, was a tenor in the court, inspired by the international success of the child prodigy Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart, who was almost 15 years older than Ludwig. Johann pushed his son relentlessly and unlovingly to the keyboard and the violin, as well as the viola. Fortunately, the court organist, Johann Gottlob Neffe, recognized Ludwig's extraordinary talents and brought him into the court orchestra as early as age 12, both as a violinist and assistant organist, while also giving him composition and keyboard lessons. The upper-class von Breuning family, whose children became Ludwig's lifelong friends and supporters, also played a positive role in teenage Ludwig's social and economic well-being.
The recently widowed Helena threw herself into her children's education, employing Ludwig in their regular teaching, and provided him with countless opportunities to perform at their private music salon, where he was encouraged to develop social skills that he wouldn't have learned at home.
This was probably one of the healthiest relationships of his life, and he later referred to the matriarch Helena von Breuning as my second mother. Also taking note of Ludwig's precocious talent was the Prince Elector of the court, Maximilian Franz, who was the younger brother of both Emperor Joseph II and the infamous Marie Antoinette. Let's listen now to a rarely heard piece from 1783 by the 12-year-old prodigy. It's from a set of three sonatas dedicated to the Prince Elector, and this is the first movement of the third sonata, and it is played by the very talented 14-year-old Christine Huang.
Thank you.
The dedication on that first edition, which was certainly not written by Beethoven and shaves nearly 2 years off of his age, reads, "My lofty sir, I have now reached my 11th year, and since then my muse has whispered to me often during the hours of devotion, be bold and lay down the harmonies of your soul. May I now, exalted prince, dare to lay the first of my juvenile outpourings at the steps of your throne." A great lover of music, Prince Maximilian was suitably impressed to sponsor an educational trip to Vienna in 1787 for the 16-year-old Beethoven to study with the great Mozart and other Viennese luminaries. Imagine what the precocious young man may have experienced visiting the bustling artistic and political metropolis of Vienna, the heart of the empire. The relative liberalism of provincial Bonn was very different from the old world conservatism of the capital of the Habsburg Empire, whose area of influence spread from the border of France to the border of Turkey in the east. There are virtually no accounts of Beethoven's brief stay in Vienna, other than his relentless attempts to meet and audition for the great Mozart. The relationship between these two strong-willed characters would have been fraught. Mozart was then 31 and with only 4 years left to live. He was busy composing Don Giovanni and struggling with never-ending financial challenges stemming from his being the first independent musician to refuse to be affiliated with any particular court or patron. Beethoven was also receiving disturbing updates of his father's decline into alcoholism, his mother's imminent demise from tuberculosis, and his parents' inability to care for the two younger brothers. After spending only a few weeks in Vienna, Beethoven received the feared news from Bonn and was forced to return home, his dreams dashed. In spite of his intense desire to return to Vienna, Beethoven would remain in Bonn for another 5 years, composing, performing, teaching, and maturing his worldview. The Van Breuning family continued to be supportive, not only financially, but intellectually, exposing him to literature that espoused the aesthetics of Sturm und Drang, storm and stress. This broad-based artistic movement that began in Germany around the 1760s challenged the Enlightenment era rules of classically ordered logic and reason with a re-embracing of the emotional, spontaneous character of mankind. In immersing himself in the Sturm und Drang writings of Goethe and Schiller, along with idealistic pillars of the Enlightenment, such as the philosopher Immanuel Kant, the young Beethoven learned to meld these two aesthetics into his burgeoning artistic worldview, rather than see them as mutually exclusive. Equally significant was Ludwig's acquaintance with Count Waldstein, who soon became his friend, lifelong patron, and mentor on the subject of social and court behavior, even when excessive formality ran counter to Beethoven's slovenly manners. Nevertheless, as a member of Prince Maximilian's court, Waldstein helped Beethoven cultivate a level of political education and awareness, rarely seen at the time outside of the elite classes. Beethoven was no sycophant, as he was proud of his strong and well-informed opinions, regardless of whom they later offended. Musically, this 5-year period back in Bonn has been overlooked by both performers and audiences. From my research, I found that from ages 17 to 21, Ludwig had a richly non-conventional education in the arts, politics, and social sciences. Reading through lists of his compositions, I realized that I knew only a fraction of that catalog of well over 50 pieces, all of which predate his Opus 1 publication in Vienna in 1795. There are many gems that show a striking maturity in the unique voice of the composer whom we have come to know. Amongst the largest and most overlooked compositions of this five-year period are two secular cantatas composed in the year 1790. These pieces are linked and overtly political in focus, which would be expected of a musician fully employed in the regional court orchestra under noble patronage. The first is a funeral cantata on the death of Emperor Joseph II. And the second celebrates the ascension of his successor, Leopold II. There are a multitude of reasons for these pieces to have come into existence, despite the fact that they were not commissioned and that neither was published or even performed during Beethoven's lifetime. Beethoven knew much about both emperors and their progressive reforms. It is likely that he initially supported their relatively progressive mandates as a response to the chaos emerging from revolutionary France, as well as the recent loss of the British colonies in North America to democratic change. Joseph II advocated for freedom of worship, freeing of the serfs, and reducing the absolute power of the church, while his younger brother and successor, Leopold II, continued some of these progressive measures, as well as abolishing capital punishment. Both brothers attempted to maintain a discreet distance from events in France and from its queen, their sister, Marie Antoinette. Significantly, their youngest brother, Prince Maximilian Franz, happened to be Beethoven's employer, the same prince who had sponsored that ill-fated first trip to Vienna. Here is a section of the Joseph Cantata featuring soprano Kiri Tekanawa and the BBC Symphony led by Colin Davis. The lofty romantic text reads, "The people arose, people in light. The earth spun happily around the sun in rays of godliness."
Thank you.
In contrast, here is a selection from the Leopold Cantata featuring soprano Chen Reis and the Academy of Ancient Music singing the more nationalistic text, "Flow with tears, don't you hear, every angel? Greet Germania above you." In listening to these pieces, we hear that the 19-year-old Beethoven had been studying not only the operas of Mozart, but of Handel and the Italians as well. 1790 was a most fruitful year as the foundation for a return to Vienna was financially laid, this time not through Mozart, but through the elder luminary and father of the symphony and string quartet, Joseph Haydn. Haydn's longtime patron and employer, Prince Esterhazy, had died in 1790, and his successor had no interest in maintaining a court orchestra. Too expensive. Haydn suddenly became a 58-year-old unemployed musician on a small pension. Several of Haydn's friends, most importantly the violinist and impresario Johann Salomon, convinced Haydn to travel to Britain, where his music and stature as a composer were already well known. The Industrial Revolution was creating enormous social change there, particularly in the growth of a middle class that wanted to share in the cultural riches previously available only to the nobility. Home music making and professional performances open to the public were all the rage. Haydn's arrangement with his former employer allowed him to publish his works under his own name, and publishers could not sell his music fast enough, especially the many chamber pieces preferred by amateur musicians. On December 26th, 1790, Haydn and Salomon passed through Bonn on their way to England, and by chance, Haydn heard a performance of one of his own masses, performed by the court orchestra, which included Beethoven, on this day playing viola. The brash 20-year-old buttonholed the elder composer and showed him some of his works. Later the same day, Beethoven's close friend, Franz Wegeler, who later married Eleanor van Brunnen, shared with Haydn the score of the Leopold Cantata. When asked if he would take Beethoven on as a composition student, the suitably impressed Haydn replied that he would when he returned to Vienna the following year. Beethoven certainly wanted the opportunity to meet and study with Mozart again. Haydn was a close friend of Mozart's and would have provided far more connections now that he was living in Vienna and no longer sequestered in Hungary at the prince's estate. In 1792, Prince Maximilian was sufficiently impressed with Beethoven's musical progress and with the two cantatas written for his brothers, and agreed to sponsor an extended visit to Vienna on full salary for studies with Haydn and Salieri and other luminaries. Beethoven's victory was bittersweet, as Mozart had died suddenly in late 1791 at the age of 35. Maximilian fully expected Beethoven to return to Bonn, but by 1794, Bonn was overrun by French revolutionaries, and Maximilian was forced to withdraw his court from the city. With the court dismantled and the prince relocated, the stipend ended, and Beethoven was free to become a permanent resident of Vienna. In 1797, he planned to dedicate his first symphony to his former patron, but it was not published until after Maximilian died in 1801. Around this time, Beethoven's mentor, Count Waldstein, wrote presciently to him, "You shall receive Mozart's spirit from Haydn's hands." The path that Mozart had forged, that of the independent composer-performer, beholden to no single employer, was to be Beethoven's territory for the rest of his life. The patronage system of subservient employment that had trapped Haydn and challenged Mozart was beginning to erode with the advent of a rising middle class and growing cries for a declaration of human rights. As an adult, Beethoven was often reported to be difficult. He likely felt that he had no true advocates, and his mood could alternate between defensiveness and belligerence. His relationship with Joseph Haydn, one of his esteemed teachers in Vienna, was fraught with disagreements and misunderstandings common in dysfunctional relationships. Although Haydn was supportive and paternal towards Beethoven, the young man was stung even by the most constructive criticism. Haydn was worried about his own livelihood as he entered his seventh decade, but Beethoven could not see beyond himself. He misconstrued his teacher's preoccupations as jealousy for his own youthful innovations. Haydn had planned to take Beethoven with him on a second trip to England in 1794, but that opportunity evaporated after Beethoven misinformed Haydn of both his financial well-being and recent compositions. An embarrassing correspondence between Haydn and Prince Maximilian resulted, in which the prince informed Haydn that he had been paying Beethoven twice the amount claimed, and that nearly all of Beethoven's new Viennese pieces that Haydn had proudly sent the prince were in fact composed 2 years earlier in Bonn. Maximilian wrote, "I fear that, as in the case of his first journey to Vienna, he will bring back nothing but debt." Here is a movement of one of those new pieces, the third movement of the second piano concerto that was actually composed by teenage Beethoven, but not published until he was 30, as his second piano concerto. Note the use of rhythmic displacement and unexpected accents in the first melody of the rondo. This is one of the hallmarks of his early period of composition, along with very compact motives, which are the bones of the melody.
Thank you.
That was Murray Pariah performing Beethoven's Second Piano Concerto, Third Movement Rondo with Bernard Haitink and the Royal Concertgebouw Orchestra. Beethoven had come to Vienna not only to seek his fortune, but also to further his education and life experience. We might regard him as a first-generation modern man, steeped in the intellectual pursuits of the Enlightenment and wanting to make a difference in society. He did not feel that societal and political change would be made by those already in power, but rather by an educated meritocracy. Unlike previous composers and performers in the great city, he had little regard for what was fashionable and limited interest in what was popular unless it served a common good. He was disciplined in both his inexhaustible work habits and the breadth of his reading. The theme of the fight against injustice became an oft-visited trope throughout his life, beginning with the influence of Friedrich Schiller's 1787 play, Don Carlos. The composer took the spirit of that play to paraphrase these maxims, which he earnestly tried to serve, as evidenced in his correspondences of the time. Do good wherever one can. Love liberty above all else. Never deny the truth, even if it is before the throne. The young composer was also tireless in securing introductions to both the Viennese nobility and members of the wealthy merchant class. These liaisons were for performance opportunities, teaching of piano and composition, and to obtain funding for new pieces. Accounts of his piano performances during the time are extraordinary. The trepidation of the 16-year-old had been replaced by a mature and unswerving sense of mission. The dedicatees of the compositions flying off his piano were a who's who of Viennese aristocracy, influential elder musicians such as Haydn and Salieri, and friends of his personal circle. Beethoven's inventiveness and virtuosity on the keyboard was compared only to that of the late Mozart, and he was feted by all manner of potential patrons, who were as passionate for his new artistry as for the gains in social status that that association gave them. The composer's frequent eccentricities and occasional rudeness were often forgiven as artistic temperament, but when it suited him, he could be humble and apologetic. Beethoven was creating new and compelling ways of expressing more than just basic moods. It was as if the palette musicians had been painting with now included new unseen colors and textures. The emotional drama and scope of the 1798 Sonata Pathétique reflects and redefines the sonata as something beyond a neatly structured personal essay of the classical era. This piece was dedicated to Prince Lichnowsky, a loyal patron and friend of Beethoven's during his first dozen years of Vienna. We will now hear the first movement played by Vladimir Ashkenazy. Thank you. Notice the scope of the five pieces that you've heard over the course of this presentation. The highly organized classical structures from Beethoven's teen years are no less organized by his mid-20s, but the emotional heft and depth are exponentially greater. All of his music during this period was immediately understood and enthusiastically received by audiences, even when it sounded new. When we enter the middle period, in my next presentation on September 15th, you will understand why this is referred to as the heroic period. It is the heroism of Everyman. Some of the hallmarks of this next era include such masterpieces as the Eroica, the Fifth and the Pastoral Symphonies, the last three piano concertos, and his one completed opera, Fidelio, the Waldstein and the Appassionata piano sonatas. These sonic, intellectual, and artistic achievements are all the more remarkable given Beethoven's gradual and irreversible onset of deafness from age 28 onward, and the almost unthinkable challenges that arose in its wake.